The presidential candidates are working overtime from a big Democratic fundraising dinner in Iowa, featuring the newly shrunken field of Hillary Clinton, Bernie Sanders, and Martin O'Malley, to fresh jabs and counter jabs on the Republican side, as frontrunners Donald Trump and Ben Carson begin to take aim at each other.
Ben Carson's a very low energy person. Actually, I think Ben Carson is lower energy than Jeb, if you want to know the truth. We need strong energy.
I don't get into the mud pit, and I'm not going to be talking about people. I will tell you, in terms of energy, I'm not sure that there's anybody else running who's spent 18 or 20 hours intently operating on somebody.
And last night, Vice President Joe Biden told 60 Minutes that the only reason he didn't run for president is that he couldn't win.
You wouldn't have considered running for president unless you thought or had some doubts about Hillary Clinton.
Not at all. That has nothing to do with it. I've said from the beginning, look, I like Hillary. Hillary and I get along together. The only reason to run is because I still think I could do a better job than anybody else could do.
So what better time for Politics Monday with Tamara Keith of NPR and Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report. Let's start by talking about Donald Trump and Ben Carson, who it appears are now about to go after each other because, and let's take a look at the poll numbers,
yes,
which explains why, all of a sudden they're tied. Or I should say, Ben Carson is surging in Iowa. The latest Des Moines Register poll has him at 28%, Donald Trump at 19%, and in New Hampshire, the latest CBS poll has him at has Donald Trump at 38% and Carson at 12%. But Donald Trump, Amy, when he's asked about these polls, you know, he likes to talk about polls.
Loves talking about the polls.
He now thinks that the polls, especially the one in Iowa where he's trailing, might be wrong.
Well, of course, because how could he possibly not be in first place? Look, I think we are now at sort of the new stage here in this campaign where we know we still have a very strong group of Republican primary voters looking for an outsider. They liked Trump earlier this summer. As we've moved on into the fall, you can already start to feel that he may have reality show lingo here, jump the shark a little bit. He's starting to wear a little bit thin.
I've heard this before.
I know. Hey, listen, here's what I will say to you.
Yes.
This isn't indicative of everything. But sitting in, both looking at data from Iowa, listening to some Republican voters in a focus group last week, they still like Donald Trump. Let's be very clear. He still has a very important place in this primary field. But what you can start to hear from voters, from Republican primary voters, is I don't know about the temperament. I don't know if I trust him in that job. Hence the rise of Ben Carson, who's the exact opposite in temperament.
Let's talk about Ben Carson's temperament. Very calm. He will admit to you he's a very calm person, which, of course, is what Donald Trump was talking about. But he said some very strong things this weekend. He said that abortion is like slavery. He has been very definitive in his conservative views. Do people like him? I mean, what explains, I guess, the surge in Iowa?
I think that a lot of people who you talk to about why they like Ben Carson actually like that he's quiet, that he's not this bomb thrower. Though the interesting thing is that a lot of the things he says, some of the analogies he makes to Nazism and some other things, are pretty inflammatory. But he says it very quietly,
kind of with agree
sort of
with
a doctor
too.
Voice. Yes, and there have been some numbers out there showing that people agree with what he's saying.
Republican. Primary voters.
Yeah, Republican. Right. And we are talking about Republican primary voters. We're also talking in Iowa about a state that is heavily evangelical in the primary. And he is appealing to that sort of very, he's a very religious person.
Let's talk about Jeb Bush, because the last time Donald Trump accused someone of being low energy, it kind of worked.
Yep.
And Donald Trump and Jeb Bush has seen the altitude going out of his balloon ever since. Is he pulling back, or is he just reorganizing himself?
It is remarkable, I think, in this race, not so much that there's an outsider energy fueling these two candidates, Carson and Trump. What I think is the most remarkable thing on the Republican side is the vacuum on the so-called establishment side, that no candidate, we thought it was going to be Jeb Bush, he hasn't lived up to expectations, and no one else has been able to sort of get in that lane as the front runner on the establishment side to match up against the front runner on the non-establishment side. So Jeb Bush, apparently they spent the weekend in Houston with big donors trying to assure them that everything's fine, we got this all under control. But it's really clear that the problem for Jeb Bush is, one, he hasn't been a particularly strong candidate, and number two, that he has a message that is not the right message for this moment. He's an establishment candidate who's talking about his record and his accomplishments as governor when Republican primary voters want an outsider and somebody who's going to shake up the system.
So obviously there are other Republicans who see an opportunity here. Among them, say, Ted Cruz or Marco Rubio.
Yes, and Ted Cruz and Marco Rubio are going for sort of different people. But in the betting markets, Marco Rubio is on the rise. Marco Rubio in these markets of people who sort of look at the odds in a sort of outsider way, his stock has risen. He is now higher than Jeb Bush. And he has been building an organization. The same thing very much true with Ted Cruz, who has an organization. He has people text in, and he even has an app. He is very serious about building an organization. And as things start to settle out, and his plan is, as things settle out and Donald Trump loses some of that
those people will
go to Ted Cruz.
Let's talk about the Democrats. They had a big weekend. You remember in 2007, Barack Obama went to the Jefferson Jackson Day dinner in Des Moines, broke out, and next thing you know, he had overwhelmed Hillary Clinton and won Iowa. Did anybody break out this weekend?
This was not 2007. There wasn't the breakout. But listen, there was a change, and you saw in Bernie Sanders that night on Saturday night in Des Moines a more pointed criticism of Hillary Clinton than we've seen before. Now, he still didn't use her name.
Which you're not allowed to, I think, at this dinner.
Yeah, but that's probably true. So it was still, it was subtle, but what he was saying, what his message is, not only I'm the candidate that is talking about income inequality and making that the centerpiece of my campaign, but I was there first on issues that are important to progressives, and I've been there when it's not convenient. Iraq, Defense of Marriage Act, and on trade.
And Hillary Clinton responded following him by throwing her arms around Barack Obama and saying, I'm the Democrats' Democrat.
Absolutely. She had people there with thunder sticks, and she learned her lesson from 2007, which was Barack Obama basically out-organized her and put on a better show, and she was not going to go into that without putting on quite a show. There was a sea of blue glow sticks for Hillary Clinton. She did make one remark that was like a little dig at Bernie Sanders, where she said, you know, people say I'm shouting too much on guns, which is actually an issue that's sort of the toughest issue for Bernie.
Yeah.
Well, you know, people often think women are shouting. It was sort of
lots of gender references.
Yeah, there was a lot. Hillary Clinton is definitely running as a woman in a way that she didn't last time around.
Let's talk about Joe Biden. We watched him last night on 60 Minutes. He gave another one of those emotional interviews, but he also said some pretty interesting things about why he chose not to run, in particular, his assessment of, Dr. Jill Biden's assessment of Hillary Clinton.
Yeah, and look, I think what he said, quite simply, I didn't think I could win. Although the biggest thing I took out from this interview was this was much more of an emotional decision than a logical decision. This wasn't about campaign finance as much as it was about a grieving father. And look,
he talked about his granddaughter saying, Pop, don't go away.
Right. Mm. I mean, tearing up. What you had to tear up when you listened to him talk about that. And it was really clear that no matter if he wanted to do this, and it's that he was running up against a calendar that wasn't going to help him. We knew filing deadlines were coming. Fundraising was going to be very difficult. And fundamentally, in order to beat Hillary Clinton, he was going to have to take the case to Hillary Clinton. She wasn't just going to collapse. No. And when you hear people around Joe Biden, they talk about him, they say he was never going to be that candidate who was going to go directly at her.
What struck you the most?
That moment that you talk about, too. It was just, it was so emotional. And also, I think that he was watching the reports, that he was paying attention to what we were saying about whether he was going to run or not.
He was annoyed
by it, and he thought, they're all getting it wrong. Because apparently he hadn't made up his mind.
And so he decided to get it right. It was a very effective and interesting way to do it.
Yes.
Amy Walter, Tamara Keith, thank you all.
Thank
Go
you.
Have
thank
some
you.
Meat.
Yes.